Good morning, and welcome to Western Mennonite Church Worship on this sixth Sunday in Lent, or what we call Palm Sunday. Our focus statement this Sunday says, "We praise Jesus along with the crowds for all that we know of his miracles and his goodness." But it so quickly turns this week to events that lead to his death. Longing to understand Jesus more deeply, we say, "Show us. Show us how to both celebrate your life and to honor your death." Our worship display this morning includes symbols of life and symbols of death. We have here some green fern branches that symbolize life. And they symbolize the people of Jesus' day waving palm branches as Jesus enters Jerusalem, waving palm branches and shouting to Jesus, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord." A very joyful time. Green ferns, green branches indicate a time of joy and life. We also have up here some crosses. Crosses that symbolize people a few days later after shouting Hosanna, perhaps even some of the very same people shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." A very terrible, horrible moment. Crosses, symbols of death. This week will hold for many of us, in many ways, times of joy and times of death. Times of happiness and times of sadness. I invite you to join me in the call to worship. I'll be asking you to respond at three different points with the words, "God's faithful love endures forever." So when I reach that point, I'll pause and hold up my hands, and the words will likely be on the screen as well, and say with me, "God's faithful love endures forever." So join me, if you would, in this call to worship. "The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has given me victory." Songs of joy and victory are sung in the camp of the godly. "The strong right arm of the Lord has done glorious things. I will live to tell what the Lord has done." God's faithful love endures forever. "Open for me the gates where the righteous enter, and I will go in and thank the Lord. These gates lead to the presence of the Lord, and the godly enter there. I thank you for answering my prayer." God's faithful love endures forever. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. You are my God, and I will praise you. Give thanks to the Lord, whose faithful love endures forever. God's faithful love endures forever. Let us pray. O God, we come to you as the people who greeted Jesus on the road to Jerusalem. We come full of joy and praise and thanksgiving. Forgive us for the times we forget to show you gratitude. Lord, have mercy. We come also as a people who were baffled when they realized how quickly their joy was turned to sorrow. Sorrow for you. Lord, have mercy. We come wanting to be with you as you enter the time and place of your death. knowing that neither can we face this week alone. Lord, have mercy. Know that Jesus does offer mercy. He offers mercy to us, and he understands that hard road between joy and devastation, between belief and disbelief. Know that Jesus will never leave you and will love you on whatever part of the road you find yourself on. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture reading for today comes from Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed him shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Let us pause for a moment of quiet silence. Lord, we thank you for these words that you have given to us, these words of Scripture, that tell us about your journey into Jerusalem towards the end of your earthly life here. May its words, Lord, may this story speak to our hearts and draw us close to you, and help us, Lord, to understand even more fully and completely what this might mean for us today. As you journeyed into Jerusalem to the shouts of Hosanna and later experienced the cries of crucify him. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we're going to have a song based on Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, hymn number 237, "All Glory, Laud, and Honor." If you're at home, feel free to open your hymn books and sing along. person, do you imagine, drives a Chevrolet Spark? It's a small car, a two-door car. I think of the person that might be driving such a car to be a young person, maybe a high school student or a college student, someone who doesn't have a family, someone who doesn't have a lot to spend on a car. The Chevrolet Spark is probably one of the cheapest cars you can buy out there. And so that's kind of the person I would envision driving this kind of car. What's your image of a person driving a Honda Accord? Now, a Honda Accord is it's a mid-sized car, a very dependable car, a car that won't give you too much trouble. It's not a flashy car. And the kind of person that I envision driving a Honda Accord would be perhaps a middle-aged person or older, maybe an older couple that are looking for something that's dependable, not necessarily flashy, but dependable. What kind of person would you envision driving an 8-passenger Subaru Ascent? This is a large minivan or SUV that has a lot of room for kids and a lot of room for cargo. I would envision the person driving this kind of vehicle to have a family. Maybe have 2 to 6 kids for needing a vehicle that can carry up to 8 passengers in it. How about this picture of a Dodge Challenger RT sports car? This is a car, this is called a muscle car. It's a car that can go fast, has a lot of power, and looks sporty. What kind of person might be driving this kind of a car? I think of a young adult, a person likely that doesn't have children, a person who might have a decent salary, because this is not a cheap car, and a person who likes to drive fast and blow by people on the road. And then here's a picture of a pickup truck, a Ford F450 pickup truck. I envision the person driving this kind of a vehicle would be a farmer or a rancher or someone who might be in the construction business, someone who has big loads that they want to haul or trailers, big trailers that they want to pull. And then every now and then you'll see on the road these long cars called stretch limos. Who might be riding in a stretch limo? Likely they would be a person of wealth, power, might be a politician like a president of a nation or a king or a queen or a president of a corporation. A person that would have quite a bit of wealth and power. The kind of vehicle that a person chooses to drive or ride in often says something about who they are or what they want people to think they are. A vehicle for many people, especially men, but often women today too, is not just a means of getting from one place to another. It's often a way of expressing themselves. It's a way of telling others who they are or what they want people to think they are. For example, I drive a Subaru WRX. I like sports cars, always have and probably always will. But I also like practicality and dependability. The WRX is a small four-door sedan, has all-wheel drive, gets good gas mileage, and is very dependable. But it's also a sports car with a turbocharger on the engine that will get me down the road and zip through those curves. When I pass another car, I don't want to just slowly edge by them. I want to blow by them so that I can get back into my own lane as quickly as possible. My car projects the image that I am fairly practical, that I'm a fairly practical guy, but who also likes the ability to go fast. And I think my car projects fairly well who I am. Whether you think about it or not, whether it fits you or not, the vehicle you drive makes a statement about you. At least it makes a statement about you in the minds of others. People have a certain image of you before meeting you. When they see what you're driving before they meet you, it has always been so. Even in biblical times, the mode of transportation a person used made a statement about them. In Jesus' day, if you rode a horse, particularly a stallion, then you were probably seen as someone who would be on the level of being a king or a nobleman or a military officer. If you rode in a chariot or on a mule, mules back then were very rare animals and were very special. So if you rode in a chariot or on a mule, you could be a military officer, you could be a government official, or you could be a well-to-do businessman. In Acts 8, if you remember, Philip met an Ethiopian eunuch riding in a chariot. And who was he? He was a very important man. He was the treasurer of Ethiopia, an official in the court of Queen Candace. He was an important man riding in this chariot. If you rode a donkey or you walked in biblical times, then you were likely seen as being a common working person or a peasant. The mode of transportation in the Bible often made a statement about who the person was. Now, when it came time for Jesus to enter Jerusalem for the last time, he wanted to make a statement about who he really was. So Jesus very carefully chose his means of transportation to convey that message. The people of Jerusalem were expecting a political or a military conqueror. And if Jesus wanted people to think of him in that way, he would have had his disciples bring him a horse, or perhaps even a stallion, or a chariot. But that's not the kind of Messiah that Jesus was. So instead of a stallion or a chariot, Jesus chose to enter Jerusalem on a donkey. Now, a donkey projects the image of humility, gentleness, peacefulness. But it can also suggest royalty. Before horses were common in Israel, kings and princes rode on mules and sometimes on donkeys. We see in the scriptures David's sons, the princes of Israel, riding on mules. And sometimes people would ride who were of some importance would ride on donkeys as well. And then we see in Zechariah's prophecy that it is the Messiah. That is the Messiah who would enter Jerusalem on a donkey. The prophecy says, "See, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Jesus chose to ride a donkey into Jerusalem to proclaim that he was the kind of Messiah prophesied in Zechariah. He was a gentle, peaceable Messiah, not a warlike or military conqueror. One's mode of transportation can be a powerful image maker. For example, what kind of vehicle do you imagine the Catholic Pope rides in? Most popes have been driven in a Mercedes-Benz limo. But the present Pope, Pope Francis, goes for more humble means of transportation. In 2013, he was driven around in a 1984 Renault that had 186,000 miles on it. It was a 29-year-old car with almost 200,000 miles on it, and here, the Pope of the Catholic Church, that was his primary or his most wanted, desired means of transportation. In 2015, when he came to visit the United States, what did he choose to ride in our country? He chose a Fiat 500, a modest family car, kind of like a Honda Accord. And then in 2017, the Pope was given a brand new Lamborghini to ride around in. A white one to match his white outfit. What do you imagine the Pope decided to do with this car that was given to him for free? He had it sold and the money given to charity. How has Pope Francis's mode of transportation affected his image? Well, he has been called the Pope of the people and loved as a very humble man. And part of that image came from the cards he wrote. Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, the modern equivalent of a Chevrolet Spark or a Ford Fiesta or a Honda Fit. And as he rides in, the people recognize the messianic image from Zechariah, that of a gentle king riding on a donkey. And they give him a royal welcome by laying their coats on the road before him. Some of them cut down branches from trees and lay those on the road before him. Part of the crowd goes ahead of him, and part of the crowd comes behind him, all of them shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." These are all acts of recognizing and welcoming royalty. But the defining symbol of who Jesus was his mode of transportation. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem made such a commotion that it attracted the attention of the whole city. People in Jerusalem started asking, "Who is this? Who is this that is making such a commotion?" And notice the response in verse 11. The crowd's answer, it's kind of a toned down response from just a few minutes earlier. The crowd's answer, "This is Jesus the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Already, the crowd is having second thoughts about who Jesus is. For now they say, instead of saying, "It's the Son of David," they're saying, "It's the prophet from Nazareth." And they're starting to wonder, can a humble, peaceful prophet from Nazareth really be the Messiah? The one who will rid them of the Romans and restore Israel to its military glory? Can a man who rides a donkey keep the people's faith that he is the long-awaited deliverer of Israel? Will they keep welcoming and praising Jesus when he doesn't live up to their expectations, to their political expectations? How long will the royal welcome last? There are already signs that it won't last long, as people start calling him prophet instead of son of David. And as soon, a few days later, they stop shouting Hosanna and start shouting crucify. What is our image of Jesus? We may have the image today of Jesus being a gentle king, but a powerful king. We have the image of Jesus as being a loving Savior, but also as a mighty Lord. That's the image we have today on Palm Sunday. But when Monday comes, when tomorrow comes, what will our image of Jesus be? Will we continue to welcome him as Savior and praise him as Lord if he doesn't live up to our expectations? If he doesn't answer our prayers for help for ourselves and our loved ones? As Monday turns to Tuesday, and then Wednesday and Thursday comes, and more people lose their jobs, and more people come down with the coronavirus, and more people die, people that we may know, people that might be our family or our friends, will we keep singing his praises? Will Jesus continue to be at the center of our daily life? Or will we turn our attention to other things, like watching the news 24/7? How will we hold both joy and sorrow together through the experiences and events of this coming Holy Week? As we approach the anniversary of Jesus' betrayal on Monday, Thursday, as we approach his crucifixion on Good Friday, let us stay faithful to the one who dies but rises to life again. If Jesus doesn't live up to our hopes, to our expectations, if he doesn't live up to our prayers, maybe we need to readjust our expectations of this king who rides on a donkey instead of a saddle, who comes to free us from our sin more so than to free us from our physical calamities. Let us not give up on him, for he will not ever give up. Let us pray. Lord, as we remember again the way in which Jesus came into Jerusalem for the last time, he came in not as a mighty military political conqueror, but he came in riding on a donkey, portraying the image of being a humble, gentle king for his people. And that is who he is. And just as the expectations of the crowd were different than what he really was, that he really wanted, sometimes our expectation of Jesus might be different than what he has for us as well. And as we come through this week of Holy Week, and we remember Jesus, his arrest, and his beatings, and his death, we experience sadness. And as we hear of people coming down sick and ill, and people dying, people losing jobs, that causes us sadness too. And yet, Lord, we know there is hope. We know that there is a resurrection coming for Jesus and for all of us who believe in Jesus. And that gives us joy. Joy to continue singing praises to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a reminder that you can be sure, and since we're not here, we're not able to take the offerings that you would like to share with the church and minister to the work of the church. So we invite you to send those offerings or drop them off at Ray and Kay's house in West Salem. So we do continue to need your offerings. We still have things to expenses to take care of, so please send those offerings in if you would. As we come to our time of prayer, we certainly have much to pray about, and you might have specific prayer requests. I invite you to pray for those during this time. God, we thank you that you are a God that we can call on in times of crisis, when life becomes very challenging, when people we love and care about, people we know, become sick with a deadly illness, or perhaps they are suffering in some other way. Lord, we know that we can come to you and call upon you, and that you will hear us. Help us, Lord, to accept whatever answers you might have, whatever gifts of life and love that you might give to us, Lord. We pray that you will be with us for that. Lord, help us during this time of anxiety and uncertainty. Give us patience and courage. Give us hope and trust in God for all the challenges that we face in this week and in the weeks ahead. As this deadly virus continues towards its peak, Lord, may we just offer ourselves and others to you, who we care about and who we love. We place them all in your care, asking for your help, for your healing, for your strength. We pray for those, Lord, who are sick with the coronavirus, that you would surround them with your love and your care, that you would touch them, that you would walk with them through this illness, and help each one, Lord, to recover. We pray, Lord, for the families of those who are sick, that they would lift up their loved one to you and entrust their loved one to you with your love and your care. And we pray for those families who have lost loved ones, both to the coronavirus or to other means of death that have come into the lives of their loved ones. Lord, surround these families, these grandparents and parents and children. Lord, surround them with your grace and your mercy. Hold them close to you as they suffer and as they grieve for the loss of their loved ones and for their inability to even be in their presence and to be with them in the last moments of their loved ones' lives. Lord, we pray for our doctors and nurses, for the medical personnel, for the first responders that are out there meeting people, helping people every day. Some of them sick with this deadly disease. And here they are reaching out and doing what they can to help them in whatever way they can. Lord, we pray for your protection over these helpers, over these medical personnel, over the first responders. Protect them, Lord. Provide a shield of protection for them from this virus, that they may stay healthy and they might be available to continue helping those who are hurting, those who are sick, those who need their help and their comfort. So, Lord, we pray for their protection, that you provide a buffer between they and whatever, between them and this illness that seeks to take lives. We pray, Lord, for wisdom and guidance for those who are the leaders of our nations, leaders of our countries of the world, the presidents and kings and queens. Lord, may you give them wisdom and guidance. Help them to make the hard choices that they need to make to help do their part to bring, to limit the effects of this coronavirus. Lord, be with leaders, with scientists who seek to find a vaccine to help treat this. Lord, there are some possibilities, but Lord, we ask that you would continue to guide and give them insight and wisdom, help them use the gifts and abilities that you have given them to discover ways to limit the effects of this dreaded disease. Thank you. Lord, we also pray for parents and children who are staying at home, who are spending every day together. Parents might be trying to work from home and their children are there. Lord, it can be kind of difficult. And Lord, we just pray that this time will be a special time for families, that even though they might get on each other's nerves once in a while, that'll be also a time when they can grow closer together, where they can share of their lives together, do things together, and experience being in a crisis together, and how the strength of family can help see them through these times of difficulty and challenge. We pray for the elderly, those who are susceptible, those who live alone. Pray that you will watch over them and keep them in your care. And we lift up those who are poor and homeless, who probably suffer the most because they have the least resources to deal with this kind of situation. We lift them up to you, Lord, and ask that you would protect them, help them to find places of comfort and care, and help them to get care when they need it, and help when they need it. Lord, I pray for each one in our congregation and beyond our congregation, that is suffering or hurting in some way, that has some need, may you bless. May you walk with them. May you help each one, Lord, find peace and hope and trust in you, no matter what. I pray these things in the name of our gentle, powerful King and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to now listen or sing along with the song in our video called Change My Heart, O God.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Change my heart, O heart, oh God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is my heart, oh God.
Come change my heart.
Make it ever true.
Make it ever true.
Change my heart, oh.
Each Sunday we've been blowing out a candle, and as you can see from our display below of our candles that are down there, this is the only one that's left, that's lit. And on this Palm Sunday, as Good Friday comes this week, we symbolize that the light of Jesus' life grows dimmer and dimmer, and then on Good Friday, it goes dark, and so also does our world on Good Friday. In some very real ways, but especially spiritual ways, grows dark as the life of Jesus is snuffed out. And now I say to you, may you find the balance that you need in the ups and downs of this week. And may you have the courage to keep walking with Jesus. Go in peace and walk with Jesus throughout this week until we meet again on Easter Sunday.